and have a glass of wine. Alrighty, as you guys are coming in, if you could all take just one quick second and look on the table, you should have what looks a little bit like a bingo card. It's a bingo card. Okay, so this is actually for the final session tomorrow afternoon, but it requires just a little bit of patient participation. Participant participation. And so you're just going to, if you read over it very quickly before I start introducing our next speaker, and just if you see or overhear something that's on here, mark it off. And then they'll be using it again tomorrow in the last session. So again, so just take a look. There is a safe place in the middle. Okay. Well, you guys came in much quieter this time. I really appreciate that. Okay. So I'm excited to introduce someone I've known on Facebook for probably the better part of a decade, but have just now met for the first time yesterday. Get to introduce Lars Avemarie. So he's a physiotherapist, writer, internationally acclaimed lecturer, teacher, and a personal trainer. He has a unique blend of knowledge about pain research, neuroscience, physiotherapy, rehabilitation, evidence-based medicine, science, and critical thinking. He's worked over a decade full-time in the health industry as both a manager and exercise and rehab specialist at the corporate level. He specialized in the training of clients with injuries and or chronic pain. So I'd like to introduce Lars, and he will be telling you more about himself.
So first, I wanted to say that I'm very, very grateful for the invitation to be here. I have been looking forward to being here all year, and I actually had planned at least twice to be here before, but, well, sometimes life happens. So, first time to be here, I'm very happy. So, it's a bit of a provocative title. This is my view of what the future of pain rehabilitation or pain management could be like or should be like. You are totally fine to disagree, and then we can have a conversation about the disagreements and we can both learn something. So this is my view of how it could be or should be done. So to preface this, and I do this on all of my lectures and my courses, I think physiotherapy, osteopathy, chiropractic, occupational therapy, and pain management is amazing. I think we have a unique role to be a very, very important step in somebody who's living with pain, rehabilitation process, and their way back to living a more normal life. So you can be a very, very important piece in this puzzle. However, many of the things we do today and that are currently be done could be done more amazingly. So we have to take all that we have learned from the past generations, and then we have to build upon that. But often, in building upon that, we also often find out that some of the stuff we did actually were not that amazingly. So basically, to learn and progress, we have to also sometimes unlearn. And that's often the hard part. So I wanted to begin with four fundamental prerequisites to future care. So if we want to do future care better for the future, which I hope is a goal for everyone, I see there's four things we need to accept before this even comes up. So the first is that we should view criticizing as something positive. It's something good. If we don't like critique, we will often try to negate and try to avoid criticizing what we're already doing. So we should really view criticizing as something positive. That's the first one. Second one is we have a lot of our practice patterns that sadly have been built on dogma and not evidence. And we need to reflect upon what we're doing in our daily clinical practice. And we have to take a stand that we really owe it to our patients. I think it's a huge responsibility to take another person under our care. So there's a Danish philosopher called Knud Laustrup, and he says, you don't take anybody under your care without holding some of that person's life in your hands. And I think that's what we do. So it's actually a huge responsibility, but with that huge responsibility also comes, yeah, we need to really put our patients first. So basically, we need to seek to be less wrong all the time. And the fourth, we need to accept and take a stand that nothing could be more humanistic than actually using evidence, using research to guide and inform our care. So there were a paper came out for, I think it was last year or the year before, which basically said that a lot of physios didn't really see a point in research. Why do we need it? And that's basically, if we don't need it and we don't feel we need it, then we're not going to use it. My argument has been, and still is, and I've been on social media a lot of the time, we really need research. So those are the four prerequisites. So basically, criticizing ourselves should be viewed as a positive act. We need to question our dogmatic practice patterns to face the challenge we currently have. We owe it to the people under our care to always try to be less wrong. And we should really try or use research to find the best possible way of dealing with another person's pain. So, a shortcut into what pain management of the future could look like. This comes from the International Olympic Committee in a consensus statement on the pain management with athletes, but I feel that this could equally apply to non-athletes. So pain is a subjective experience dependent on complex interactions by neurobiological, cognitive, affective, contextual, and environmental factors. Thus, pain management depends on identifying contributing factors from biological, psychological, contextual domains and addressing them through various evidence-based techniques. So that is, in my view, sort of what future pain management and pain rehabilitation could look like. Then when we get into the details, that becomes increasingly more complex. So, in this context that I'm standing here and you're sitting here, you need to know a little bit about me. Now, you got a short introduction. I will do another short introduction. So basically, I'm a science-based full-time physiotherapist, a writer, teacher, and lecturer. I'm an external teacher at the physiotherapy program in Copenhagen. Then I, in 2014, co-founded a pain education company or continual education company. Where I taught pain and pain science and pain research to clinicians. And then I worked as a chief scientific officer for a small health company. And right now, currently, I work full-time as a physio in rehabilitation. So, and then I travel around places, beautiful places like this, giving lectures, and I've gone through the years given lectures to a multitude of companies. So that's the short introduction about me. So basically I preface every course I do around the world, basically mostly Europe, that's where I rule, with saying that the number one error at the course is me. Meaning that my course is a collection of errors I have made and I try to cheat those errors so people don't have to reuse my errors. So they can become even better than me, hopefully, because they don't need to do all the stupid shit that I did. So basically, I thought about making this sort of t-shirt and having it on myself the first day of the course. So back to the topic at hand, the future of pain rehabilitation. From my view and my understanding of the literature, we should not only look at the body and biomechanics and biomedical view on pain, we should look more about a neurobiological and behavioral approach. So those two topics have, in my view, should have an increased focus for the future, and there's a lot of gold lumps, clinical gold coins that we can find within those two topics. So, this is from Max Sussman back in 2005. It's a commentary on a paper he did, but I think he hits it on the nail with this commentary, meaning that in typical medicine, we mostly look at anatomy, but it's often viewed as the beginning and end, and he's arguing that it's only the beginning, not the end. So in my view, there's so much more than anatomy. So yes, anatomy is very important, but it's not the end. It's only the beginning. So pain has clear emotional and behavioral consequences. So I believe that we should learn and be taught anatomy, but we should also accept and adhere to the raising research that states that pain has so much more to do with the psychology and behavior than it has with only the body. But still, these psychological factors are not routinely assessed in physiotherapy clinics, nor are they successfully utilized to enhance treatment. So basically, I think that a lot of the stuff we have learned through the last 10 years have the potential to better our treatments to a great deal. So basically, when we work with people and not cadavers, as Dan Jacobs has a great article about, we should be working with behavior. So if we're working with people, we're working with behavior. We're working with psychology. And we need to accept this, and we need to become much, much better in this field. So, an example of this complexity and this more biopsychosocial view of pain, where we accept not only anatomy but also psychology, is in the case of nonspecific low back pain. So we have continual research showing that between 80 to 95% of patients with low back pain has no pathological or anatomical cause for their pain. And this is from multiple studies. I'll give you a second to read that. So an often typical pushback towards a more psychologically informed way of doing physiotherapy or pain management is that with some cases, there may be specific back pain. There are a multitude of gurus and expert clinicians that totally negate this information, where we have some of the smartest researchers in the world looking as careful as you can on the human body and coming up short. They totally ignore this, and then they say that they can find a specific anatomical cause for low back pain. But that's really not how we should deal with it. We should really accept that in most cases, and we have a lot of research supporting this, low back pain is much more complex. It's not patho-anatomical. And in the cases where we actually have specific low back pain, you should actually not go to a, what you call, normal healthcare provider. You should most likely go to a doctor. Shouldn't be treated by a physio. You could be treated by a physio continually, but if you have specific low back pain, you most likely more need a doctor than you need a physio. So back to the thing we talked about earlier with our practice patterns, a lot of the stuff we do in clinical practice and in our dogmatic practice patterns really does not fit. It doesn't fit with how the research view pain right now. So often in these cases, when we look at the different things and different theories we use to explain what happens in the body, they sound pretty impressive at the beginning. They are often quite detailed onto what happens within the body. But when you start just thinking a bit about them, asking the right questions, then it all of a sudden becomes quite obvious that, well, it's really not that simple in any way. And it's really, really not that clear what is happening. So often we have a lot of impressive theories about what happens in the body, but when we try to predict those theories, they often totally fail. So our theory should not only be sound impressive, they should not only be very detailed, but they should also hopefully predict. And this tendency we have in the medical field to focus on trying to find, as Professor O'Sullivan speaks about here, the magical solution, magical technique, magical injection, magical surgery to solve the problem. And as I have been preaching on social media, on my lectures and in my courses, we should focus not so much about this magical solution. We should more accept that there is no magical solution and try to use what we have right now. So the basis of these biomedical models, or the basis of this biomedical thinking is the biomedical model, which is called also rephrased as the apparatus error model. Defining that all illness and all symptoms arise from an underlying abnormality within the body. And the basic biomedical reasoning, and I teach this in physiotherapy school, and I can say the students are not happy when I bring this up. This is basically all of their teaching until they meet me. Then they get pretty frustrated pretty quickly. So this is the basic reasoning model. So we have an abnormality that leads to pain or sickness. The idea is that if, or assumption is that if we remove that abnormality, then of course there will be no pain and no sickness. That's the basic assumption. So it's trying to find the dysfunction, trying to find the misalignment, trying to find the faulty movement pattern, or whatever you believe in, and then try to normalize it, and then everything is good and the pain goes away. The first problem is with this, and I pinpoint this in my course to define what is abnormal, to define what is a dysfunction. We need to know what normal is. And in many cases, we don't. So we really can't say anything is abnormal if we don't know what normal is. So I had my teaching in running analysis. At physio school, we had 3 days doing this. And then I asked the clinical instructor, I asked him, well, what is abnormal? How do you define that? How do you define that there's too much pronation? And then he said, well, when I see this, then it's too much pronation. Then I was like, but do we have any paper that actually states that this degree of pronation is abnormal? No. Okay. Do we have any paper that actually showed that this certain degree of overpronation leads to something in the future? No, he didn't. And then he continued teaching 2 days on running analysis. So, then we also have an idea about this find it, fix it, which is somewhat correlated with a biomedical view and the biomedical reasoning that I mentioned before. So, the role of the physician has been to find a problem and fix it. Now, this can in some cases be right. Sometimes there is a problem. Sometimes we can fix the problem. But when it comes to the beast called pain, it's much less about finding a problem and fixing it. It's much more complex. This idea about fixing the body has had a multitude of, had received a multitude of critique through multiple papers. This is a new book by Professor Nichols mentioning it. It's free to download. Very good read. So the body is less of a car that needs to be fixed, in my view, and more like its own ecosystem, as the statement by Gregory Lehman here, Dr. Lehman. So a less wrong view of the body, if we have to meet, if we have to use a metaphor, and all metaphors are at some point wrong, but if I'm forced and the hands are tied behind my back and I have to use a metaphor, the body is much more like a computer with multiple systems and much less like a car. Another thing that that makes the biomedical model obsolete and really shows the complexity of the pain experience is that pain exhibits degeneracy. So basically, a person with pain in the same location may be totally different. This is often quite ironically reflected in questions to me at my course or questions online where the question is, well, this is all great, Lars, but tell me how do you treat a person with knee pain? Totally negating that the person with knee pain could be totally different from the other person with knee pain. So basically the idea and the tradition of regional specific treatments I'm quite critical towards. So one leg of one person and another leg of a person isn't the same leg. It's sitting on a different person. So we need to accept this, but often we don't. So basically pain with the same location and the same character may be associated with different cortical activation patterns. and what may be influencing the pain could also be totally different. So again, it's much more complex. So what I've been trying to reframe pain, what pain is as a multidimensional experience produced by multiple influences. Another shortcut towards what future-based pain rehabilitation could be is trying to make the treatment focused towards accepting that sentence. So, in my view, modern pain management should be informed by both qualitative and quantitative research, including research topics such as the experience of pain, shared decision-making, therapeutic alliance, patient empowerment, patient communication, patient-centered practice, risk factors, ideas about hypertrophy, the idea about movement variability, clinical decision-making, just to name a few. So basically, there is a big, big field of research we have currently that we can use to better the decisions we make with people who live with pain. And we need to accept that nonspecific factors like therapeutic alliance, patient belief and expectations, therapist confidence and pain characterization and self-efficacy are more predictive of clinical outcomes that changes to the target of therapy, like muscle timing, posture, joint position. So is Ben here? No? He's not. He's there. Great. So he had a great post a long time ago about we listen a lot to patient history, but we really don't talk a lot about their expectations. But expectations is actually a great predictor of outcomes. So we should be talking a lot more about expectations. So instead of us looking and examining a foot and using 15 minutes to look at the patient's foot, I would argue that we should look up and look upon what the foot is attached to, meaning a person. Now, of course, it can be important to also look at the foot. But my argument is that we should not only look at the foot, and we should not spend 20 minutes looking at the foot and then having 5 minutes to look at the person. Another common argument that often comes up when talking about a more research, more modern view of pain rehabilitation is that, well, what if I don't have evidence? What if I don't have research? What do I do then? But often this is a straw man. Often the person that is questioning did not look at the research. They did not search for this particular topic. And even in the rarest of diseases, like neuralgic amyotrophy, there is a substantial amount of research that can inform our decisions to the better. So I had a patient with a very unlucky patient who had this symptom, bidiagonal. So basically, it could be rephrased as not having any deltoid muscle. That's the basic sign. So the branch of the brachial plexus, which innervate the deltoid muscle, is deteriorating, so there's no stimuli, no activity. So basically, after a while, you don't have any deltoid muscle. It's almost into the bone, and then the tricep comes. So it looks quite easy to recognize once you know what it looks like. This is very, very rare. It is estimated that 1 to 3 persons per 100,000 has this, or are unlucky enough to have it. My patient had it on both arms, which was very unlucky. But even with this, the rarest of rare diseases or symptoms, I could find multiple reviews and research that could inform my practice for the better. I could even tell from this research that what the doctor ordered did not make any sense, sadly. Then, from my standpoint, future-based care is not tool-based care. So I think we should throw away the clinical toolbox, and we should work more on a process-oriented reasoning that Jason Silvernail has been talking a lot about. I'll give you 2 seconds to read that. So a funny question or sad question or how you rephrase it is when people use a tool-based oriented approach, when you ask them why they choose that particular tool to that patient, they quite quickly have problems finding the answer. So often it's a total random process. It's basically, well, this didn't work, then I try dry needling. That didn't work, then I try stretching, something else. It's not process-oriented. So, in my view, pain management of the future should accept plausibility, uncertainty, and complexity. And plausibility, here is Professor Novella talking about it. Plausibility is essentially an application of existing basic and clinical science to a new hypothesis, giving us an idea of how likely it is to be true. So it's highly likely that Earth is a spheroid, basically round. It's highly unlikely and unplausible that it's flat. That process can also be applied in physiotherapy. If you apply a plausibility filter towards any treatment modality, you will quickly be shown that a lot of the stuff we do and we do in our traditional way are highly implausible. So basically, you could use plausibility as a bullshit filter. Or as a young physio from Sweden told me, that I was a firewall for bullshit. I took that as a compliment. But you can use this idea of plausibility and asking hard questions to actually make the decisions and the treatments that you provide to your patients of higher quality. So future-based care, in my view, is also accepting that pain is an experience. It's a bodily experience like standing in Norway looking at northern lights, freezing your ass off. It's a very bodily experience, but it's still an experience, as stated by the ASPS. So pain is an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience. We should accept that it is an experience, and we are working with another person having an experience. So, to this future-based care, or care for the better, or my view of what the future could be or should be, there are many barriers. So basically, in pain rehabilitation, there are four fundamental problems right now, as I see it. So first is a lack of science-based knowledge. So basically, if I look at my teaching into what science is from my bachelor in physiotherapy, it's really not flattering. Then we lack education about pain, which Dr. Noel also talked about. Then we lack skills of critical thinking, and we really don't learn this at school. And then we lack a comprehensive perspective on pain. And those four problems are often interlinked. If you don't really have a good idea about what science is and the place of science and how to use science, then you really have no value in science. And then you often also lack the idea about pain science. Why should I be interested in pain science? I don't need it. So much of our education as healthcare providers are focused on rote learning rather than promotion of critical thinking. So basically, it's memorizing facts. Some of the best co-students that I were with were great memorizers. They were great at learning, absorbing a lot of stuff, standing up, saying the stuff the teacher said, and then trying to forget everything, because then the next education module had to be done, so they needed to learn a lot of new stuff. From my experience, asking critical questions to the teacher doesn't go well. And I quickly found out that asking critical questions to the teacher that's at some point most likely gonna grade you, maybe not so good idea if you want to pass an exam. Yeah. And then many healthcare providers lack a comprehensive perspective on pain. That has been very well documented, that we lack a lot of knowledge of pain. So a paradox in this, and this was funny enough mentioned by the previous lecturer, if you want to learn a lot about pain, hours, I'm not talking quality now, I'm just talking quantity, you should become a vet. So basically, pain curricula in health facilities, this is hours. So basically, to become a vet, you have approximately 88 hours of pain teaching. Then we have physiotherapy, right below 40. Then we have medicine. And another study found that pain education accounted for less than 1% of program hours. 1%. Yay! Yeah, and another paper found that the hours of pain education is woefully inadequate given the prevalence and burden of pain. That's why it's great that there are so many people here. Another study looked at the current pain education within 242 undergraduate medical studies across Europe. And my home country, so I live in Sweden, but I am Danish. But here, my home country comes in on rock bottom. Basically, there's no hours allocated to the Bachelor in Medicine program to teaching about pain. Zero. And the red bars, I'm not so happy with either. So the red bars are choice modules. So basically, you could choose that you don't want to learn about pain. In my book, you shouldn't be able to make that choice. Another study looked at the implementation of EASP's curricula in 208 undergraduate healthcare programs in the UK. They found that, almost all of the programs did not implement the current guidelines. Only two had implemented it. So another barrier to this future-based view of care, it is what has been called the failures in 20th century medicine. So there's a great editorial from the chief editor of the American Physiotherapy Association. She did an editorial on this. So most people think that it's ignorance. And to some degree, it may be. That's the biggest problem in medicine. A limited understanding of all relevant physical laws and conditions that apply to a given problem or circumstances. But I would argue, and it's done so in the paper, that it's not ignorance, it's ineptitude. So, ineptitude, meaning that knowledge exists, but an individual or group fail to apply that knowledge correctly in a particular circumstances. So basically, we have clinical guidelines on low back pain. The current low back pain guidelines from the American Physiotherapy Association are excellent. They are very, very good. We have a lot of knowledge. I think they are somewhat 32 pages or something. Quite good. They clearly state that we should not give patho-anatomical explanations for the cause of pain. They clearly state that we should not use educational strategy that might directly or indirectly increase the perceived threat of low back pain. They are really good guidelines, but they're not used. So we have a lot of knowledge, a lot of research-based knowledge that we can use, but isn't being used. And this is ineptitude. So, what does all this mean? So if I were to go through all of the possible modalities that are being used in pain management right now, it takes me, on my course, it takes me somewhat almost 3 hours. And I think that is somewhat important, but clearly I can't do 3 hours in 45 minutes. So instead of doing that, we could use, as I told earlier, use plausibility as a filter. What we do with patients should first and foremost be plausible. Or we could use a shopping list approach. So most of the stuff here I've talked about, but some of the stuff I haven't talked about. But this is my shopping list to future-based care, better care for the future. So it should be biopsychosocial, it should be multifactorial, it should be neurophysiological and behavioral, it should be patient-centered and process-oriented. We should use a consistent clinical reasoning process, meaning that the approach we take to dealing with one problem is the same approach we use on another problem. It should be interactor-oriented, not operator-oriented. We should use analytical processes, approaches. And we should acknowledge and accept plausibility, uncertainty, and complexity. So, a nice quote to summarize what I've been talking about. Medicine is a science of uncertainty and an art of probability. Then I'm actually ahead of schedule by 2 minutes. Giving a lecture the first time is always a bit daunting, because I can say I'm getting better at it. But often the first times I had way too much material, so it almost became, the last 5 minutes became a tsunami of slides, just ramming down. But I'm pretty happy about myself that I have 2 minutes to go. So then I want to say thank you a lot.
All right, so I'll be honest, it was really great to hear you finally talk. Like, that was, I really enjoyed that. But okay, let's get to the questions. So let's start, we're gonna start with Caitlin Fritz. She goes, what about pain that is not always an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience, tattoos, BDSM, et cetera? What is known about this, and is there a way to apply this to future care appropriately?
So I were at a lecture with a pain psychologist 2 months ago, and he talked about an old book about how to deal with pain, and he mentioned that there's some data or some assumptions made that pain that is more unpleasant, pain that is unknown, is likely to pose a higher risk in developing chronicity. So yes, there's something about that. The research about it, not so much. So there might be something, but I need to do a literature search to show that. But it's a very interesting topic, and intuitively can be totally wrong. That should be said, but intuitively there could be something about it. That actually what we experience and how we experience it poses a great way of either making the problem bigger or smaller. So often, from my clinical experience, when the pain is unknown, of unknown origins, it poses a bigger risk than it does when it's not known. When I bump, if I bump the foot on something, it has a clear cause that, well, I bumped the foot, it hurts. But if I all of a sudden get back pain from no apparent reason, if the pain doesn't make sense, then that could pose a bigger problem. Was that answer enough? Perfect.
Okay, now from...
There's actually a great talk by, I can link to it in the group, by, I can't remember his name. Is it Steve Kemper? No, it's not Steve. It's, well, he's giving a lecture from the annual lecture from the American Physiotherapy Association, and he compares the experience of a tattoo artist with the physiotherapist. And he makes actually this, he sort of makes the argument that the tattoo artist actually is more versed in the living experience of pain and actually more doing rightfully what pain science is supporting, because he's doing something that actually will be painful, and therefore he learns a lot about the painful experience, where a lot of physios shy away from the pain part. But then they also shy away from the part about the learned experience. So that's a great lecture. There's both a paper and there's a lecture. I think it's 1 hour lecture.
So should we start tattooing our patients?
Maybe we could start having a side job as a tattoo artist. Yeah.
Okay, so I have another question from Jeffrey Rufila. How do you approach your treatment when the patient's expectations are not in accordance with evidence around persistent pain?
So patient's adherence is a big thing, but I think as healthcare providers and as skilled healthcare providers, we should have, or hopefully have, a way to deal with patient goals and patient adherence in a more psychologically informed way. So often we jump the gun, and the idea is that we must do everything what the patient says we should do. But often, I don't see this coming up if we have made sure first and foremost that we will do everything we can in our power to make the person better. If we can communicate that in both a verbal and nonverbal way, perceiving that we are caring, and first and foremost forming a solid therapeutic alliance with the person that is sitting in front of us as the first thing we do, then that question often does not come up. So basically, not because we're mechanics, but basically if you trust your mechanic, you don't go to him saying a particular part needs to be replaced. That's the expert's job. So if you trust your mechanic, you will go and say, this is the problem. And he will try to do what he can to help with the problem so that it doesn't exist again. If you don't trust him and you don't agree with him, then you will start to mingle with his professional choices. If he all of a sudden wants to change out the whole engine costing $10,000, then you might pick another mechanic or say, I don't want that, can you just change that? But if you have formed, from my experience, if you have formed, and there's some, actually there's a new paper came out 2 months ago which stated sort of this. It was from Professor Sullivan's group, that you, in order to make people adhere to a more biopsychosocial view of pain, you need first and foremost to form a solid therapeutic alliance with them. And if you do that, then they often will not come, is my personal experience, and ask for a particular treatment. Because they know you are the professional, and they know you will do everything you can to help them become better.
Okay. So the next question is from Bradley Jahl. What are some good questions to pose to clinicians who are convinced that the patho-anatomical / biomedical paradigm is correct?
So basically it's sort of the view the way I view it is try to disrupt automated thinking. And Socratic questioning is a great tool in trying to force reflection. So asking reflective questions that force the clinician to try to reflect upon the assumptions they are making can be a great tool. Now, can it be done online? I'm not so convinced. No. That's why I much rather, when we talk about trying to get clinicians to get a more evidence-based, research-based, curant-based view of pain and pain management, I want them to see them live. I don't think that can be done with a high success rate on social media.
Okay, the next question is from Michelle Kleiner. Could you please expand on what you mean by the interactor approach? How do you recommend our biomedical professions go about enacting this approach?
So there's a great editorial by Diane Jacobs, who's sitting here, looking into the interactor and operator mindset. So I would highly recommend reading that. So basically, and there's a great article also on Diane Jacobs' blog about manual therapy and doing a more focused, more interactor way of operating. So basically when I alluded to earlier that you are looking more at the foot of a person with foot pain than the person, you are more a operator. You're operating another human being. You're trying to fix something in that person's body, which actually can't be done. So an interactor is more alluding to you're interacting with a human being that has choices. And this is basically also supported and somewhat the other side of the same coin regarding clinician-centered practice and patient-centered practice. So often an operator approach will be clinician-centered, not patient-centered. So when you're patient-centered, it's much more about having a dialogue with the patient, which we should be having. Not so much just saying what they need to do. Okay, this is what you need to do. You have shoulder pain. You need to go out to the gym, stand in the corner, stand with a yellow TheraBand, and you need to do some exercises that nobody else is doing. Everybody's looking at you. You can't play golf, which you like, because you need to do these particular exercises. And then they come back the next week, and we ask them, did you do the exercises? No. And then we get angry. That's really not patient-centered.
Okay, now our next question. Keep moving. It's from Linda Crawford, who I believe was watching at home. There are studies that indicate that generalization of skills taught and practiced in the clinic to the everyday life of a person in pain are not optimal. Addressing the importance of experience, what changes do you think we should consider to improve this in the future?
That's a really good question. Yeah, actually, I don't know. I have no answer for that.
I think that's a sign of a really great lecturer slash teacher. I don't know.
But it's a really good question. Somebody should photo that and send it to me. And I have to think about it. Really good question. So Jason Souvenil had a great lecture that in Oslo at Pain Cloud, which sadly does not exist anymore. That's a side note. But about we only look at the 1 hour we have the patients in our hands or in our presence, but we should be much more looking into the 23 hours that the patient are in there. And that's basically a great topic.
Awesome, and we have time for one more. So this one's from David Walton. How do you reconcile the inherent tensions that treatment should be both evidence-based and embrace the complexity of the person? That is, are clinicians not adhering to evidence-based guidelines, or are guidelines built on incomplete, non-person-centered evidence?
So first, if you read the research, it quite literally, quite quickly becomes very evident that it's highly complex. So if you read the research, you will find out it is complex. If you read the guidelines, which is 32 pages, and trying to apply these guidelines, it's not simple in any way. So basically, you have to accept that it's always complex. Then how I deal with the inherent tension? Well, when I did my bachelor in physiotherapy, I stayed off social media for two whole months. That was a great way of dealing with my tension. So then working in a facility that is, as sort of sounds strange if I say pro-choice, because that means something else. But if you work in a facility that is pro-choice, meaning that you choose what you do with patients yourself, that is much better for my degree of tension. Instead of me working a place which I have colleagues work that, where the clinical director states you should do more of this treatment, you should do this, and where you often get a lot of patients from colleagues, and where you totally disagree with what they have done. So basically in Sweden where I work, we have a hospital system where I can actually go into a database, and I can see what every physio and every doctor have written for the last 10 years. So the patient I talked about earlier with the neuralgic amyotrophy, I could view all of her treatments. And I could say that I blankly were in total disagreement what were being done with her. So working in an environment where you are the white sheep in the black flock, or whatever we could call it, that can really have tension. And I had a lot of colleagues that end up quitting their job to a more pro-choice environment where they can choose how they treat. And it's not dictated, and they're not surrounded by people doing low-quality treatments, because I don't think that's a viable option. You will, frankly, lose your mind quickly.
Agreed. Yeah? Awesome. So that's the last question for this session. So that means that it's lunchtime. Really great lecture. Thank you. So there's a lunch buffet out here to the side. Again, if you have more dietary restrictions you want to make sure you can meet, cross the street at the Hyatt. There's also a couple other little like sandwich shops, little places over by the water if you're interested. Might I suggest you come back at 1:25 if you're interested at all in winning the raffles? Because the raffles, you must be present to win. Okay, so 1:25-ish, and then we'll start the next lecture at 1:30.